Swayam Prabha. Digital India. Educated India.
Welcome to my last lecture in this course. Today I will talk about an interesting and important concept called modular arithmetic, and we will see a couple of applications of such modular arithmetic in the domain of cryptography. Okay, to start with, let me revisit the concept of congruence modulo n. We were already exposed to this concept in your equivalence class, equivalence relation parts. So anyway, so suppose that n is a modulus and it's a positive integer, and usually it makes sense to take n greater than equal to 2. N equal to 1 case is not good. Anyway, n greater than equal to 2, we call this n a modulus. From this is modular arithmetic. This term is coming. Anyway, I define two integers a and b to be congruent modulo n if n divides a minus b. Equivalently, a and b are congruent modulo n if the remainder of division of a by n and the remainder of division of b by n are the same. Okay. And whenever a and b are congruent modulo n, I use the special notation to denote this. A is congruent to b modulo n. Now, you can see that congruence modulo n is an equivalence relation on the set of integers. For example, I quickly visit the properties of equivalence relation. Reflexive, everything divides 0. So a minus a is 0. In particular, n divides a minus a 0. Therefore, a is congruent to a modulo n. So this relation is reflexive. If n divides a minus b, n also divides b minus a. So if a is congruent to b modulo n, b is also congruent to a modulo n. Therefore, this relation is symmetric. Finally, if n divides a minus b and n divides b minus c, that is if a is congruent to b modulo n and b is congruent to c modulo n, then n also divides a minus b plus b minus c, which is a minus c. So a is congruent to c modulo n. That is, this relation is also transitive. Okay. Therefore, congruence modulo n is an equivalence relation on Z. And whenever we have an equivalence relation, I always have a set of equivalence classes under that equivalence relation. And in this case, you can see the equivalence classes are the class of 0, the class of 1, the class of 2, and so on up to class of n minus 1. And so these are the possible remainders when I divide integers by n, the modulus. Okay. Now, these classes are usually infinite. Not usually, they are all infinite classes, infinitely many members in each class. So we usually, in this case, what we do is we pick one representative from each equivalence class and we say this stands for the entire class. So natural choice in this case is pick 0 from this equivalence class, 1 from this equivalence class, 2 from this equivalence class, and so on. Okay. So this essentially introduces the concept of a set Zn which is as a set, can be taken as 0, 1, 2, 3 up to n minus 1. Okay. And now there are several ways you can view this set Zn. One possible view is this set of all possible remainders of Euclidean division by n. You can also view this as representatives of the equivalence classes. Okay, the elements of Zn as representatives of the equivalence classes under congruence modulo n. And there is yet another, I would say, algebraic description of Zn. We have not covered this. Just for the sake of completeness, I mentioned that. But also an algebraic description. It is the quotient structure Zn equal to Z by Nz, but this quotient is formed with respect to this quantity Nz, which is called an ideal of Z. Anyway, whatever way we view this Zn, it does not really matter. We can simply view it as the set 0, 1, 2, 3, n minus 1. What we do, we define two operations. Whenever a, b are in Zn, define the following operations. So these are modulo n, addition and multiplication. So I can for the moment use this notation in order to distinguish this sum, which is basically a modulo n sum, from an integer sum, which is here. So I have two integers a, b less than n. First, I add them as integers. If the sum is less than n, I will call it the modulo n sum also. Otherwise, if it is greater than or equal to n, it cannot be too large, so I just subtract one instance of n from this sum. Then I get a number in this range, and I call that the modulo n sum of a and b. And likewise, I have to define some product. So this is defined this way. Product modulo n. This is first make the integer product a times b. And then take the remainder of Euclidean division with respect to the modulus n. Now it is an easy matter to check that under these two operations, this set Zn is a commutative ring with identity. Okay. Commutativity follows because these operations, they are commutative for integers. A plus B is same as B plus A. AB is same as BA. Okay. So it inherits commutativity from set Z. And with identity, this 1 is there. This acts as the identity, multiplicative identity. And this is definitely the additive identity, 0. Okay, so this is a commutative ring with identity under these two operations. Henceforth, I will no longer use this plus underscore n or dot subscript n. Instead, I will always use the congruence notation. Something congruent to some other thing, modulo n. Okay. For the moment, I have introduced these notations just to make it look like conventional while defining a ring. Okay. Anyway, so this is a nice ring, commutative ring with identity. But then, whenever you have a commutative ring with identity, you can talk about the units of that ring. Okay. So, I now prove a very important theorem that characterizes all the units of Zn. This says that an element A in Zn is a unit if and only if it is coprime to the modulus n. Let me give a short proof. The proof is not difficult, but anyway, let me give the proof. So, for the first if part, That is, I start with the assumption that GCD of A and N is 1. Then there exist integers U and V such that UA plus BN is equal to 1. This can be computed using extended GCD algorithm, like extended Euclidean GCD algorithm that we have covered earlier. And we also saw that we can choose U such that it is in the range 0 less than equal to U less than N. Okay. But then modulo N, this term vanishes, and we see that U times A is congruent to 1 modulo N. So U is nothing but A inverse modulo N. Okay. So this is one side. For the second side, we start with the fact that A in Zn is a unit. Then I have to show that the GCD of A is 1. Okay. So if A is a unit, we know that there exists some U, such that when I multiply U by A, we get 1 modulo N. Okay. Now, if I consider this as an equation rather than a congruence, then I must have UA equal to 1 plus some multiple of N. Okay, this modulo N is some multiple of N. Now if I look at the GCD of A and N, so GCD of A and N that divides A and therefore UA, GCD of A N divides this N and therefore VN. Therefore the GCD of A and N divides this minus this, which is 1. So if an integer divides 1 and is known to be positive, it has to be plus 1. So the GCD of A n is 1. So we have seen this notation earlier. Zn star is the set of all elements A in Zn such that the GCD of A and N is equal to 1. So these are precisely the all the units of Zn. Right. And what is the size of this set? This is precisely the Euler totient function phi of n. Okay. So you have defined phi of n that way. And now you understand this totient function plays a very important role. Right. Now, you note that the units in any ring, they form a group. So Zn star is a group under multiplication modulo n. Okay. And the size of the group is phi of n. Therefore, from Lagrange's theorem, it follows that if A is an element in Zn star, then A power phi of n must be the identity, multiplicative identity. So A power phi of n must be congruent to 1 modulo n for any A in Zn star. This is known as Euler's theorem. There are number theoretic ways of proving this also, but anyway, since we now already have some algebraic results at our disposal, we can have this simple algebraic proof. Now, a special case of n is of concern to us, namely n is a prime. Okay. If the modulus is a prime, then except 0, every element of Zp is coprime to p, because this is a prime. Therefore, Zp star will be nothing but 1, 2, 3 up to p minus 1. In particular, phi of p is p minus 1. Now, if I apply this Euler's theorem to the special case of primes, prime modulo, I get what is called Fermat's little theorem. So, if A is an integer not divisible by p, we have A to the power p minus 1 congruent to 1 modulo p. This is a very important theorem called the Fermat's little theorem. Okay. Okay. So, these are the essential results we need to know for understanding our treatment of cryptography. A very brief treatment, of course. But before doing that, we will see that such a primitive called modular exponentiation is frequently used in cryptographic primitives. So, what does it do? So, it's basically this problem. If you are given some A in Zn, not necessarily Zn star, any A in Zn, and some non-negative exponent E, integer, non-negative integer. I want to compute A power E, but modulo n. Okay. So this process is called modular exponentiation. Okay. So I now give you an algorithm for this. It is called a square and multiply algorithm for modular exponentiation. So first I present a recursive version of the algorithm, and then I will convert this recursive algorithm to an iterative one. Okay. So this algorithm goes like this. So inputs are A, the base, the exponent E, and the modulus N. I want to compute the return A power E modulo. So definitely if A is 0, we return 1. Okay. Otherwise, if A is greater than or equal to 1, I divide E by 2, R is the remainder, F is the quotient. So F is nothing but the floor of E by 2 and R is the remainder. So it's a 0, it's either 0 or 1 because you are dividing by 2. Then what you do? You recursively call modular exponentiation on A, F and N. Okay. But then if I look at A power E, this is nothing but A power 2F plus R, and this returns A power F. I need to square it because of this 2. Okay. So I square it first. And then if I see, if R is 0, you do not need to do anything. Otherwise, if R is 1, then you need to multiply T by 1 upon itself. And then you return T. Okay. So this is a straightforward modular exponentiation algorithm. Important thing is that after every square or multiplication, I am reducing the product modulo n. So all these intermediate values, T here, T here, T here, they are in the set Zn, less than n, greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Now, I can simply convert this to an iterative function this way. So, R is the least significant bit in the exponent. You are first processing the more significant bits, and at the end, you are considering the least significant bit. Okay. So, this leads to the following iterative algorithm. So just look at the bit pattern in the binary representation of the exponent E. Let us say it's an L bit number. Call these bits EL minus 1, EL minus 2 up to E0. And then you have this. Initialize T equal to 1. Then you keep on looking these bits from this direction to this direction. So this is often called left to right binary or exponentiation. So you just square T, and if the bit is 1, you just multiply. And when this loop breaks, you simply return T. Okay, so this modular exponentiation is an important thing that many cryptographic primitives use. Therefore, we spend some time on it. The next question is, what is the running time of it? Usually you will see that E is no bigger than N. And in that case, it can be shown that the running time of this is big O of log N whole cube. Anyway, it's not a very important thing at the moment, but it's good to note this. Okay. So with this basic introduction to modular arithmetic, we now switch to a couple of applications in cryptography. Okay. The first one is called the Diffie-Hellman Key Agreement or the Diffie-Hellman Key Exchange Protocol. This was indeed the first public key cryptographic primitive designed by Whitfield Diffie and Martin Hellman in 1976. Now, this research was motivated by the fact that, suppose that there are two parties, Alice and Bob. They want to share a secret by communicating over an insecure or public channel. Okay. Anybody can eavesdrop and see or hear whatever Alice and Bob are saying. So, the question is, can they still do it? Okay, can they still share a secret for future communications? So they came up with a very brilliant idea. This goes like this. First, Alice and Bob agree upon a suitable finite group G. It may be an additive group or a multiplicative group. But here, let us say this is a multiplicative group because the example that we will see for G will be a multiplicative group. It is a finite group. So, let N be the size of or the order of the group G. Okay. Let us assume that this group is cyclic and suppose that they publicly decide a generator G of G. That is, a generator means g power 0, g power 1, g power 2, g power 3 and so on up to g power n minus 1 exhaust the entire set g. Okay. Okay. So, this is what is called the setup class. They decide between g and the generator small g of capital G. Now, Alice generates a random element in the set 0 to n minus 1 and computes this quantity g power a and sends that thing to the other part, Bob. Okay. So, once again you see that this is an exponentiation going on. That's why we actually talked about modular exponentiation. Then, Bob does a very similar thing. Bob generates another random b in the set 0 to n minus 1. Bob then computes g power b in this group and sends that quantity, that group element to Alice. Now what Alice does? Alice has received g power b from Bob. Alice generated a, so she knows this. So she computes the quantity g power ab by exponentiating Bob's contribution by this A. Okay. On the other hand, Bob computes, Bob has received G power A from Alice, Bob knows B, so Bob computes this quantity as G power A whole power B. So this is now a common element that Alice and Bob share. They can now use this quantity as a shared secret for future communications. So, the question is, why is it, what is the security behind this? In other words, why is it difficult for an eavesdropper to calculate the same secret, g power ab? Let us review this question. How difficult? So, what does an eavesdropper know? He knows a description of the group capital G. By just listening to this channel, conversation between Alice and Bob. If stopper also knows this generated G, he also sees G power A and G power B. Now his task is to compute G power AB. Okay. This problem is known as the computational Diffie-Hellman problem or just simply Diffie-Hellman problem. Okay. So is it a difficult problem? Okay, I will review this question little later. Let us introduce another concept. A is called the discrete logarithm of g power a to the base g, and b is called the discrete logarithm of g power b to the base g. So these discrete logarithms are unique modulo the order of the group. Anyway, whatever it is, if the eavesdropper can compute A from G power A or B from G power B, then he can actually compute the shared secret G power AB. And this computation is called the discrete logarithm problem, DLP. And one thing is clear, if discrete logarithms can be computed easily, then the computational Diffie-Hellman problem can also be solved very easily. Okay, so if the DLP is easy, then the computational Diffie-Hellman problem is also easy. What about the converse? This is not exactly known, but it is believed that this is also a difficult problem. Okay, I would say if this computational Diffie-Hellman problem is easy, then DLP is also easy. However, there is no solid proof for this. Maybe I propose a related problem. Given G, same G, G power A, same G power B, and I have given you some H. Your task is to decide whether H is G power AB. This is a decision version of the Diffie-Hellman problem called the decisional Diffie-Hellman problem. Then, for some groups, all these three problems, the computational Diffie-Hellman, discrete log, and decisional Diffie-Hellman problem are assumed to be difficult. So, now can I have a concrete group where I can run this Diffie-Hellman protocol? The answer is yes, I can actually have. So, you choose this large prime P and take g equal to zp star. Its size is p minus 1. This is known. Moreover, we know that for a prime p, this group of units of zp, zp star, which is of size p minus 1, is cyclic. Unfortunately, it is not very easy when p is a very large prime to compute a generator of this zp star, unless you know the complete prime factorization of p minus 1. So if p is a large number, factoring this p minus 1 is a very difficult problem. So what we typically do, this is now an easier problem. You somehow generate a large prime p such that p minus 1 has a known large prime factor q. Okay. So, there are algorithms for doing this. Okay. Now, p minus 1 by q, this factorization you perhaps do not know, but it suffices to have a large prime factor q in p minus 1. And there are algorithms for generating such p. Okay, given a large prime factor q. That's not a difficult problem. Then, what you do, randomly generate elements h in g and compute h to the power p minus 1 by q. Now it is easy to see using Fermat's little theorem. If g is not 1 modulo p, then g has order q. And if so, I can take the subgroup of zp star generated by this quantity, which is of order q, instead of this full g, full zp star. Okay. So this way we can avoid this factoring of b minus 1. And the discrete log problems for ZP star is difficult for a suitable choice of p. Currently, we know only something called sub-exponential algorithms. These are super polynomial time, but not fully exponential. So, this is apparently a good group for implementing the Diffie-Hellman key exchange or key agreement protocol. Okay, so having seen this first application, I switch to a second application. This is called the RSA crypto system, and turns out to be this is the first public key encryption scheme invented by Rivest, Ronald Rivest, Adi Shamir and Leonard Adleman in 1978. So this is the first public key encryption algorithm. Now suppose that Alice wants to send a secret message to Bob. Okay. So Bob has some bookkeeping to do before Alice can do so. So Bob chooses two large primes P and Q and computes the product N, which is PQ, and the Euler totient of N, which we have seen to be P minus 1 times Q minus 1. Okay. Then Bob chooses some exponent E such that this E is coprime to this quantity, not N, phi of N. Okay. And since E is coprime to phi of N, E is invertible modulo phi of N. Okay, we have seen this already. Let us say D is the inverse of E modulo phi of N, not N, modulo phi of N. Now what Bob does? Bob publishes N and E, whereas Bob keeps D secret. So this is called the public key, this is called the private key. Okay. This is known to everybody, even attackers. This is kept secret. Okay. Now, Alice is ready to send secret messages to Bob. Somehow Alice encodes her secret message, which may be an English text, English paragraph or whatever, to some element M in Zn. N is known, can be done by Alice. Then what Alice does, she raises M to this power E modulo N. Okay, so Alice generates something M power E modulo N, generates the C, what is called the ciphertext, and sends this C to Bob. Bob, upon receiving C, decrypts or recovers M using this equation, C power D modulo N. This is as simple as this. But then question is, why? You first raise something to the power E and then that thing to the power D, why do you get back M? So this correctness requires a proof. Okay. So, recall that D is the inverse of E modulo phi of N. That is, E times D is congruent to 1 modulo phi of N. Okay. Therefore, I can write ED equal to 1 plus some multiple of phi of N. K is an integer. And phi of N we know to be P minus 1 times Q minus 1. Okay. Now take any message M in Zn. If P does not divide M, then by Farmer's little theorem, M power P minus 1 is congruent to 1 modulo P. Okay. Therefore, what is M power ED? Let us see. This is nothing but M power 1 plus K P minus 1 Q minus 1. So M power 1 I write here. And this term, second one, second factor, I reorganize this. So M power P minus 1 whole power something. But this is 1, so 1 power something is 1, so I get back M. Okay. On the other hand, if P divides M, then we anyway have M power ED congruent to M, which is congruent to 0, both are congruent to 0 modulo P. Okay. So in either case, irrespective of whether P divides them or not, we always have M power ED is congruent to M modulo P. And the same thing holds for Q. That is, M power ED is congruent to M modulo Q. Therefore, it follows by the Chinese remainder theorem that M power ED is congruent to M modulo M. That is, if someone first raises to the power E and the other one raises to the power D, you get back the original message M. So once again, you see this involves this exponentiation modulo M, M power E, M, C power D. Okay. So this is a very primitive operation in cryptography. Like Diffie-Hellman, we need to review the security of the scheme, why it is difficult for eavesdroppers to break this system. So there are two problems of concern in this context. So one is called the RSA key inversion problem. So N and E are published by Bob. If somehow D can be computed from N and E, then anybody can decrypt. Okay. But we know that there is a proof that this problem is as difficult as factoring N. There are proofs for this. But even without knowing D, an eavesdropper may succeed. That is called the RSA problem. So N and E are public. Ciphertext may be intercepted by the eavesdropper and compute M. Possibly the knowledge of D is not necessary. Now, this RSA problem is not proved to be as difficult as factoring N, but currently we do not know any way to solve the RSA problem other than by factoring N. Okay, so it is believed that this problem is also as difficult as factoring N, but maybe easier, we do not know. We do not have a complete proof. But one thing is clear, that the RSA's security is somehow tied to factoring this product N equal to PQ. Okay. But when PQ are sufficiently large, factoring large N is very, very difficult. And once again, we have some sub-exponential time algorithms, which are not polynomial time. So, once again, RSA seems like secure. So, that's all about these two applications that I wanted to say. But just as a passing comment, I mention a very interesting recent development. Not very recent actually, but this is a result that you should know. So far we have assumed that the factoring problem and the discrete logarithm problem are suitably difficult. But in 1994-1995, that time, a person called Peter Shor, an American mathematician, proposed polynomial time algorithms for quantum computers, not our classical computers, for both the factoring problem and the discrete logarithm problem. And therefore, in the quantum world, Diffie-Hellman and RSA are not secure. So you can compute discrete logs, you can factor large things. However, there is a catch here. Quantum computers are apparently very, very difficult to build. The engineering problems seem to be very, very huge. And we have some prototype quantum computers, but they really cannot handle very large instances of factoring and discrete logs. In fact, people have used quantum computers to factor integers like 15 and 21. That is just for demonstration that quantum computers can run Shor's algorithm, but factoring a suitably large integer, like a 1024-bit integer, seems still out of reach. Anyway, but people are still, material scientists and engineers are still continuing their research to build practical quantum computers, and I have heard some recent developments from IBM, maybe also from Google. In any case, I am not sure whether any they still pose any threat whatsoever to DP Hellman and RSA. But in cryptography anyway, people are aware of this and they talk about what is called the post-quantum cryptographic schemes. So these are more complicated in any case. We still do not know what will happen, so only time can tell it who will win. Okay, so this is all I wanted to say about rings, modular arithmetic, and a couple of applications in cryptography of these discrete structures. So I am now going to complete all my lectures. So this is my last lecture. I hope you have all enjoyed this. And so bye. Stay safe. Thanks for attending. Bye.